We're going to go ahead and get started. Welcome, everyone. My name is Karen Zagantz, and I'm the director and flute faculty for Z-Tunes Music, a music school right in downtown Atlanta. I'm excited today to welcome the Atlanta Symphony Orchestra oboist Emily Brebach as our clinician today. Ms. Brebach has been playing English horn and oboe with the ASO since 2012. She's performed with several orchestras throughout the United States, including the Boston Symphony, Houston Symphony, Kansas City Symphony, the Minnesota Orchestra, the Sarasota Orchestra, and the Sarasota Opera. Brebach is an artist affiliate instructor of oboe at Emory University, a faculty member of the Atlanta Symphony Orchestra's Talent Development Program, and she maintains an active private studio out of her home. So for today's clinic, we're going to stay on mute while Ms. Brebach works through the GMEA oboe audition excerpts. You can type any questions you have in the chat box, and I'll ask them at the end of each excerpt. All right, over to you.
Hi, everybody. Thanks for joining in today. I'm excited to work with you guys on these GMEA etudes. I just heard that you guys haven't had this music for very long, so hopefully this is a good way to kind of introduce you to the some of the challenges and some of the good stuff that's in this music, and we can go from there. Okay, so I'm going to start by playing the first etude for you. So this one is marked Andante. So follow along in your music, and don't be afraid to type in any questions in the chat box, and we can definitely address them as they come up. All right, everybody ready? Here we go. So there's a couple of things to think about when you're on this etude. Whew, sorry, I'm out of breath. It's always tough to talk right after I play the oboe. So first of all, this is marked andante, which usually is a slower speed. We think about it as being sort of on the slow end of the tempo spectrum. But they call for a metronome marking of 90. So it's actually not the nice flow to it that you're using your metronome to make sure that you're pushing the piece in the right tempo direction. The other thing to think about is that this is a very flowing, very legato etude, right? So we have a whole lot of slurs. We have a couple of tenuto marks over notes. So that's like in measure 1, 2, 3, measure 4. The pickup into measure 5 has that tenuto mark over it. So we always want to be thinking about a broad, beautiful sound. So at the beginning, we have mezzo forte. And you should think about that as a beautiful, sort of easy sound, sort of your middle range of your dynamics, nice and beautiful, nice and round. If you're using vibrato, this is a great time to really try and use vibrato on these first notes, on these dotted quarter notes. Right, we get a nice, beautiful sound if we're using vibrato. If you're not using vibrato yet, just think about making the most beautiful sound that you can. You're using a good embouchure, firm corners, a flat chin, all that good stuff. Now we have all of these grace notes, right? So in measure 3 and measure 7, all over this etude, we have these two little grace notes that happen in the middle of the bar. They're almost always actually before the second beat. I'm just noticing that now. So what I like to think about is these are like little trills. So I think about them as using a trill fingering. So for example, in measure 3, I'm going to use either and then just lift up this first finger. Right? That's the trill fingering. So one more time, fork def. And if you just lift up your first finger, you can get the trill fingering for a G. Or use left F and then pick up that first finger again to get a G. Whichever one you're more comfortable doing, both of those would be a good time, good fingering to use here. I don't think you need to go all the way up and down off of a full F to a full G because it goes by so quickly. Right? It kind of gets a little clunky. And because, again, it's not actually slow, it's worthwhile to just, I think, find the trill fingerings. I'd say either forked or left F. Either one, you pick up that first finger. In measure 7, we have an E flat to an F. I would use forked F, E flat to a forked F, right? So that, again, you're just lifting one finger. That's the goal here. F to G again in measure 9, 10, 11, 12, measure 13. And then the second measure is E flat to F. So we talked about all of those trill fingerings. So that's what I would recommend for those. Going back to what I was saying earlier about the flowing, beautiful legato etudes, we have these tenutos, right? It's pick up to measure 5, pick up to measure 9, these pick up quarter notes. And the tenuto just means long as you can make that note while it's still a quarter note and in time, right? So dee-da, not dee-da, right? So we want, oh, I have water. Oh, I have water. Right, not. Right, so it's a subtle thing, but just making sure you're really sustaining through. And again, vibrato is going to be your friend here if you're using vibrato. Sorry, give me one second to get that water up. Okay, and then we have in measure 9, 10, in measure 11, we have a diminuendo, but look at where we're coming from and where we're going to. So we have a forte in that pickup to measure 9, and we're only going down to a mezzo forte at the end of that diminuendo. So that diminuendo is not going to be all the way down to your softest dynamic. We're dealing little kind of in subtleties here. And then we have the pickup to the third line, pickup to measure 17. It's an eighth note pickup, and then the downbeat of 17 is a piano. I personally think that pickup should be piano. So don't try and make that pickup mezzo forte and then be quieter at the downbeat of 17. I think that you can play that with a piano pickup. And then underneath the music in that third line, crescendo poco a poco, right? Poco a poco is a little, which means we have to stretch out that crescendo from 17, 18, 19, 20, all the way to the downbeat of 21, right? So what often happens is we end up crescendoing too much too soon, right? That's, everyone sees a crescendo, they go, okay, I need to be loud. But in this case, you really need to kind of pace yourself, right? You need to make sure that you're not gonna find yourself at your maximum volume in like that second measure, right? In measure 17 in measure 18 or measure 19. So do some crescendo at the beginning, but the bulk of the crescendo should be right at the end. So it really sounds like okay, on the downbeat of wherever that is, 17, 18, 19, 20, and the downbeat of 21. And then again, we have that tenuto mark over the B flat in 22 at the end of the bar. And again, that just means really, really nice, sung, beautiful, as long as you can physically make that quarter note and still be in time to the next note. And we have a slight writ at the end. So what that means is another thing I often hear students do is when they see these ritardandos, right, which means to slow down, is they often all of a sudden play at a different and slower tempo, right? So this is not, it doesn't mean to all of a sudden change tempo. It means to gradually dial down the tempo, right? So because we only have basically two notes to do it, what you really want to think about is that F, the last note of that second to last measure, is going to be longer than the G, the second to last note. So dee da dum is kind of how you're going to make that ritardando happen. Okay, so I'm going to play through this one more time, so you guys can get it in your ears, and then I'll ask if there are any questions, and I'll talk through anything else that I've forgotten about in this etude. The next one is quite a bit trickier, so I don't want to spend a ton of time on this first one, but I'm always happy to answer whatever questions you might have. So, one more time through the first etude. Thank you. So that was one more thing I did want to talk about, is how to practice fitting in the grace notes, right? Because they're a little awkward, right? We have all these eighth notes going along in a line, and we have to fit two extra notes between the end of beat one and the beginning of beat two. So just remember, these grace notes always happen before beat two, which means you need to take time out of the and of one, right? So let's see, let's look at a specific measure, for example. So in measure three, our first grace notes, we have an E flat on the and of one, and then we have two grace notes, and then that F, which means you need to cram in those two grace notes at the end of the and of one, right? So we always want to make sure we're on time to that second beat. Ba-da-ba-da-da, ba-da-ba-da-da, right? So the F is going to happen right on the beat. So you see how they're really quick, right? So that's why I'm recommending using the trill finger if you're able to for these grace notes. But if you're having trouble fitting it in, if it doesn't seem to make sense, obviously the first thing to do is to practice it without without the grace notes, right? Right, and then just try and put your metronome on. So I put my metronome on at 90. Ooh, it's a little bit faster than what I was playing it at. Like I said, this is not a slow, not all that slow. And then I would just try and fit in beat one and land on beat two with the grace notes. Right, just making sure that we're landing on that the second beat right on time, and we're not late. So we have to, again, just those two grace notes, to think about them as being part of the and of one. The other thing I did want to talk about that I remembered as I was playing it through the second time is I want you to think about the ends of the long legato lines, right? So we have a long legato line, and at the very end of it, we have to articulate a different note, right? So really make sure you're blowing through that last note of every legato so that you're moving and your tongue just touches the reed, right? So we're not going to stop the air. We're not going to stop the music. We're not going to stop the line, you know, the musical flow, all of that good stuff. None of that's going to happen. So we're just going to keep blowing through and articulate the next note. So again, something you can do to practice this is to practice it all slurred. So for example, the first two measures. Right, so if you practice it like that, that's what your air should be doing. And then you can add in the tongue so that the tongue doesn't interrupt. It's not, right, we don't want any kind of hiccups. We don't want any kind of heavy tongue. Just a really light tongue going through so that we can really play use that really beautiful legato line. So this is a really great piece to showcase sound quality, right? So really thinking about playing, there's a million different components of sound quality, one of them being, you know, good embouchure, correct air usage. Vibrato is an element of tone quality. And really trying to maximize the beauty in the sound. So if you're finding that this piece is easy for you, this is a great time for you to start thinking about working on your tone quality, working on your vibrato, working on seeing how beautiful you can make it, which is really one of the oboe's best qualities, is our beautiful sound and our ability to play these beautiful long lines. So I think that this piece brings that out really well, and it's a really great exercise in creating a beautiful sound. So I'm going to stop here for a second. Does anybody have any questions they want to type into the chat? Any questions whatsoever? Would you guys like me to play it one more time? Again, crickets. Okay, well, I'm going to play it one more time for you, just so that's what's going to happen. And then we're going to move on to the fast one. Okay, here we go. Great. So I did see one question come, and the question is, where should I be breathing? That's always the question, isn't it? This one is actually laid out really well, and there are eighth rests just about every four bars, right? So we have an eighth rest in one, two, in measure four. We have an eighth rest in measure eight, in measure 12, in measure 16, and measure 20. I think the places that are the best places to breathe. There's really not any other place to breathe in between, right? And like I said, this quarter note equals 90. Again, it's just a little bit faster even than what I was doing. You're not going to be spending a lot of time playing without having enough time, or you're not going to run out of air. I don't think so. If you take a nice big, deep, low, not stressed out breath, you'll be able to get through and take those breaths in the eighth rest. And you're absolutely right. It's not a lot of time, right? An eighth rest is pretty short, but I think that you'll still that's still plenty of time. And if you need to, just take a hair off of the tied eighth note before almost all of these rests, right? So cut that. Make sure that you're holding for a full quarter note into beat two, and then take a breath, and then start on beat three, right there. But those are the rests here are the really the best places to take a breath. Do we have any other questions? Any other questions? We can always go back to this too if you think of something after I'm talking through the second etude. I'm happy to answer that going back. Or if you have any questions, just oboe related in general, I'm happy to answer that. Or about the English horn, which I have back there. Okay, so I'm going to move on to the second etude. This is the fast one. Give me one second to get that water out of my B flat again because we are in F major. Okay, so this one is marked Allegro Giocoso. And Giocoso means important thing to remember when you're playing this one because this one can get pretty aggressive if you're not careful about bringing the joy. Okay, so here we go. Allegro Giocoso. This one's over pretty quick too, but it has a lot more notes in it. Okay, so like I said, this is Allegro Giocoso, which means joyful, which means all of those accents we have at the ends of the bars shouldn't be really heavy, right? We want to do those accents with air, and we don't want to make the tongue the super heavy thing that makes the accent, right? Can just kind of feel down and low, and it comes to a stop. Those accents is kind of being more about the air. Again, if you're using vibrato, this is a great place to use vibrato. Vibrato can be a really great way to bring attention to a note when you don't want it to. So again, this would be a prime example of this. Since this is Allegro Giocoso, since it's joyful, we're mostly thinking about trying to bring out that note without bringing the music down. And then we have a couple of weird articulation marks, right? So in measure four over beat three, big beat three, so the last of that measure, that C, right? This is a marcato mark. Again, it's kind of short and kind of marcato literally means marked, right? So you just want to kind of point it out. You want to kind of bring attention to it. And it's funny that it's at the end of a phrase because I always tell my students to end your phrases beautifully, right? To work, make sure that the note's just a little bit longer, that it ended, that it's all beautiful. But this is the opposite, which is has these kinds of contrasts in them. So, right? So again, we want to be thinking up. We want to be thinking light. We want to be thinking, all of that buoyancy, all that kind of stuff is where we want to focus with this, so it doesn't end up right. We don't want to, especially on a C, right? A C on the oboe can tend to be pretty careful about it. Really only think about the lightness and the buoyancy. The other thing I want you to notice is at the beginning is marked forte. It's not marked fortissimo. It's not marked triple F, right? It's just four. So don't feel like you have to play at your maximum volume when you start this piece. And that's, again, that's going to help to give it that lightness, that joyful quality, as opposed to aggressive and something that's more kind of down and heavy, right? So lightness in the sound. You still want to play at a volume that's, of course, you don't want to play quietly. And then we have these a recurring theme of two measures of forte and then a mezzo piano and a crescendo forte. So I think the important thing here is to not give away the mezzo, right? So make sure that you're playing forte through the end of the bars before the mezzo piano, so that the mezzo piano sounds very sudden. The musical term for a sudden change in dynamic is subito, right? So we have a subito mezzo piano. We don't want to go, right? We don't want to kind of diminuendo. Oh, there's my dog. My dog here. Here's the you want to diminuendo it. It diminuendo takes all the guts out and the surprise out of the mezzo piano. And then we have a bunch of like left F, forked F issue here, right? So when we with on the oboe, there's three ways to finger an F. There's the normal way, there's a fork, left F, right? So we always want to avoid going from an E to a forked F, right? That is not, these two fingers don't want to do their thing at the same time. So that's why, one of the reasons why we have left F. So I mean, I would even use left F for the Fs in here when you're coming to or from a D. Using a left F in measure 2, left F in measure 6, using a reg 8, left F when the key change. Oh, that's another thing. Make sure you're paying attention to the key change when we go into B flat major in measure 9. So all of these things are going to be helpful for you. Let me think. I'm just trying to think if there's other places where, oh, so for example, here's an example of what I was talking about. So measure 12, you see how there's you go from an E flat at the end of measure 11 to an F to an E natural, right? So that's the place where, again, you don't want to find yourself on forked F and then going to an E on the first two notes of measure 12. So you really do need to use a left F there. And you can use left F for the other F in the second beat if that's what you're more comfortable doing. And then we have a repeat of the beginning. So if you've learned the beginning, you've pretty much ended this piece as well. Going into the ending section, the starting at measure 17. When you get into measure 16, make sure that you're not, there's not too much time between the end of measure 16 and the beginning of measure 17, right? So one and a two, three, one and a two, and we're going straight forward into it. And then again, we have the accents, right? Buoyant and happy and vibrato-y and brilliant on the accents, but not heavy. And then we have the mark measure 20, and then make sure you're not going on autopilot. So you remember how I said that if you've learned the beginning, you've learned the end, all the way up until you get to the last two measures. That's where you can, your autopilot can lead you astray. So that's kind of the main thing to talk about in this one. I want you guys to be thinking, if you have any questions, to type them in, and I'm going to play this through one more time again, and it probably will jog some other things loose and tell you guys about this piece. Okay, one more time, through Allegro Giocoso. Thing to think about this is that I'm playing it pretty darn fast, right? This is a pretty darn fast piece. You don't need to start that fast. it's always best to start slow, especially because you have quite a while before you have to audition on this, right? So it's always best to start slow. So put your metronome on not 126. Put your metronome on, you know, half that even, just to start, really to try and get all all the notes, because again, like there's some like at left forked up, you know, nonsense going on in there that can be kind of tricky. But make sure that you're starting slow so you can get all of this good and then start to move the metronome up. And if you don't get it up to 126 by the time of the audition, play it at the tempo that you can play it. I always tell my students that it's way better to play something clean and slightly slower than to play it at tempo and sloppy. So obviously aim to get it up to 126 by the time of the audition. But if you can't get it up there, if it's at 116, I personally would highly recommend playing it at that tempo, as opposed to playing it just fast and sloppy. Do we have any questions whatsoever? Anybody? No, anybody have any questions about the English horn? Oh, right there. No, anybody want to hear any of that again? Anybody want to? Nothing.
That's all right. Well, thank you, Miss Emily. So thank you for your insight on that. I learned a lot and I'm not even an oboe player. So thank you so much for joining us and doing that. And good luck to all the students who are watching this on your upcoming auditions. Look out for more communication from ZTunes on lessons and upcoming clinics for Allstate and more. And otherwise, have a great week.